Hello everyone, massagebf.com. This is Ken Francis. I'm going to be doing another commentary on a recent presidential address from the White House. The last time I did this, I got really, really mad, and I need to try and keep my cool. It really upsets me whenever I have to, you know, I become aware of somebody who's as ignorant as Obama is. And you know, it really gets me emotional because I don't understand how anybody could be so dumb. You know, it just doesn't make any sense to me. So I'm going to try and keep my cool this time, but I'm going to be doing my own commentary again. So here we go. Again, I'm gonna try to stay calm. Just try. Can't make any promises.
Pioneers and champions.
This guy right here, he lost his son in basically a mass shooting. And there are a lot of other people who have lost people that they care about to guns. But most of them are smart enough to not blame the guns. This guy is going to blame the gun for some misguided reason. I don't know what his disability is. But you can see how this guy's wearing a suit. You can see how he conducts himself. This is why we need to be careful. Because just because somebody looks intelligent, just because somebody looks like they've got their stuff together, that's not necessarily true. And in contrast, this is basically why I personally, I refuse to actually put on a suit for any reason. If I can't wear my regular street clothes, then I'm not going to go to whatever it is that, you know, I may be planning on going to. Because it's kind of like how the Catholic priests, they wear these little white things around their neck to let you know that they're clergy. You know, I don't agree with that. Because anybody can be putting on a costume, you know? So, you know, this guy is basically going to blame the guns. And I'm paraphrasing, of course. He's gonna kind of talk about it using his own words. But, you know, it's interesting because there's not a whole lot of people who have lost loved ones to guns that actually blame the guns. They blame the person who did it. This guy is going to give us a very different take on that. And it's very interesting because he conducts himself in a calm manner, but he's clearly not calm because when you're calm and when you're collected and organized, you're able to actually think clearly. Or at least you're supposed to be able to.
It's such an honor. On the morning of Friday, December 14th, 2012, my sweet little boy, my 7-year-old son Daniel, was among 20 first graders and 6 brave educators who were shot to death at Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut. In the 3 years since those 26 precious lives were lost at that school, far too many more lives have been lost to gun tragedies in this country. Far too many people right now who are hearing these words are grieving the loss of a loved one to gun violence. As a nation, we have to do better. We are better. We're better than this. In April of 2013, I had the honor of introducing President Obama in the Rose Garden. And unfortunately, that was to announce that a bill that had been proposed to close the loophole in the federal background check system for firearm sales had been blocked by members of Congress. Some members of Congress.
Constitution carry is not about the wild, wild west. The reason why we have the Second Amendment is because Americans who choose to do so need to be able to protect themselves. And the entire Second Amendment, from start to finish, it's not about the army. It's not about law enforcement, it's about regular Joes, such as myself and everybody else, regular people, regular Americans. That is what the Second Amendment is about. The entire Second Amendment is basically about us. It's our right to bear arms. And it's there for a reason. And so, the truth is that Sandy Elementary School, they did not have teachers that were armed. They did not have a principal that was armed. They didn't have a means to protect themselves, and that's a choice that they made. And I don't want to seem insensitive. I don't want to, you know, I don't want to come off as a total, you know, asshole that just doesn't care. I do care, but these people had a choice, and they chose to not exercise their right, and that's their choice. And so, you know, there was a massacre. It really is that simple. And so I just wanted to kind of point that out to make it perfectly clear. You know, individual, and I've said this before, individual ignorance does not constitute a change in reality. It never will. It never has. And that's just the way it is. So when you have an entire school that's full of ignorant people, you know, you can't blame the guns just because you made a mistake. You know, I mean, if I see a gun-free zone or if I go somewhere and if I'm open carrying my handgun and if they ask me to leave, then I'm happy to leave and they're just going to lose my business. But, you know, I'm happy to leave because gun-free zones are basically the ideal condition for the next mass shooter. And again, we have the Second Amendment for a reason. I've actually heard of people saying that the Constitution is outdated, and you gotta wonder, Where do people like that, I mean, what are they putting in their cereal that makes them that stupid? Because the level of ignorance that is required to actually think that is just astonishing.
But President Obama delivered an address that day that was palpably charged with genuine passion and commitment. The president made a promise to not give up. I remember standing there with my family and Vice President Biden, listening to our president speak, and our feelings of despair were replaced with feelings of hope. And I remember thinking, who's going to help him with this? That's a tall order. So since then, I've come to know and respect and learn from many amazing individuals and organizations who are doing good, smart work in this space. And many of you are right here, right now. Many of the folks in the Gun Violence Prevention Coalition, including Sandy Hook Promise, have had numerous meetings with Vice President Biden and President Obama and their top advisors to address this issue. But we can't do it alone. And the president can't do it alone. The thing is, every gun-related death is preventable. And we need your help. We need everybody engaged in this.
Okay, so he just said that every gun-related death is preventable. That's false. That is absolutely, totally false. Yeah. So I just wanted to kind of point that out. I don't really need to say much more than that.
President Obama made a promise as an elected official and a promise as a father that he would do everything in his power to protect our nation's children, to make our communities safer, and curb the loss of life to gun violence in America. So today, we celebrate.
Okay, so he just made. Yeah, he just made another very interesting statement. He just said that the president made a promise to do everything in his power to curb or to make things safer. The president is pushing for more gun control, which is the exact opposite of making things safer. If you want things to be safest, it's never going to be totally safe, but if you want things to be as safe as it could be, then what we need is constitutional carry, which means no gun laws at all, because the Second Amendment is our law. We already have a gun law, it's the Second Amendment. So constitutional carry is going to make things as safe as it could possibly be. Let's continue. So, he made a true statement, but in this case, however, President Obama is extremely ignorant, and so that's why, you know.
Great. Another example of how President Obama and Vice President Biden continue to keep that promise.
There's the false statement right there. There it is.
It is with such great honor that I introduce to you the President of the United States, Barack Obama, and Vice President Joe Biden.
The president is basically going to spend a lot of time just trying to sympathize for people. It's going to take him a minute to actually get into the more meaty parts.
About an hour later, Gabby first opened her eyes.
He's a slick president, so, you know, he's gonna pretend like he actually cares about people.
Those people are here today.
So let's just kind of skip over that because it's all lies. He knows exactly what he's doing. He simply doesn't care. He wants to put more American lives at risk.
Despite the fact that there's a general consensus in America about what needs to be done. That's part of the reason why on Thursday I'm going to hold a town hall meeting in Virginia.
There is a general consensus in America of what needs to be done, and that general consensus is that we need constitutional carry. We don't need gun control laws, and I know that because I've been spending a great deal of time on YouTube about this subject and online and, you know, just talking to people. You know, so I know that. There is a general consensus. And this general consensus is not agreeing with the president at all.
So. On gun violence. Because my goal here is extreme. Care enough about a little boy like Daniel.
You got to skip ahead some more here.
Responsible law-breaking few from inflicting harm on a massive scale. Today, background checks are required at gun stores. If a father wants to teach his daughter how to hunt, he can walk into a gun store, get a background check, purchase his weapon safely and responsibly. This is not seen as an infringement on the Second Amendment. Contrary.
Yes, it is an infringement on the Second Amendment, and yes, it is seen as an infringement of the Second Amendment. That was another lie. So you see, you've got to be careful, and you got to watch carefully, because our president lies constantly. He's constantly lying to meet his agenda. So you got to be careful, and you got to pay attention. Any type of background check is seen as an infringement. Anything less than constitutional carry is an infringement. And it's only going to put people at risk.
To the claims of what some gun rights proponents have suggested. This hasn't been the first step in some slippery slope to mass confiscation. Contrary to claims of some presidential candidates apparently before this meeting, this is not a plot to take away everybody's guns. You pass a background check, you purchase a firearm. The problem is, some gun sellers have been operating under a different set of rules.
Obama thinks that that if you're on the no-fly list, then you shouldn't be able to get a gun automatically. But there's been 7-year-old boys on the no-fly list. It's basically because their name was a lot like somebody else who was on the no-fly list, and that's why he couldn't fly. There's been senators, U.S. senators, on the no-fly list. You know, just because of errors. You know, it's because of just, like, the whole system is screwed up, and the government, it's, you know, they don't need to give anybody due process before they put somebody on this list. So they can put whoever they want on the list without giving a reason, without due process, without a court or a jury. If there's no plot to do mass confiscation, then why even try to implement these laws in the first place that require background checks, since we have the black market? Law-abiding citizens are the ones that are going to be going to a gun store to buy a gun and doing the background check. Criminals who know they cannot pass the background check, they're not going to go to a gun store because they're not going to waste their time. They're going to go through the black market. And the president knows this. I mean, I'm sorry. I mean, I call him stupid. But that's because he's acting stupid. He's not really stupid. He knows exactly what he's doing. That's precisely the problem. And that's why there are people out there who are worried that he might not leave office when he's supposed to. That he's going to start a war and use that as an excuse to stay in office. Because you got to wonder, why is the president doing this stuff? you know, it's not about safety. He knows it's not going to make people any safer. It's going to make people less safe.
A violent felon can buy the exact same weapon over the internet with no background check.
Currently, there are websites that are basically the black market. Not that the websites themselves are bad, and not that the owner of the websites are bad. The reason why these websites are basically considered the black market is because of the laws that are in place. The actual infringements on the Second Amendment, those laws that require background checks, are what make these websites, part of the black market. And even if you require background checks through these websites in order to keep them legally operating, according to this flawed, broken, you know, individual's opinion, you're still not going to take down the black market. The black market is not something that anybody can take down. It's simply a group of people who are working in collaboration with each other. And so since it's impossible to take down the black market, that's why we need to have constitutional carry. That's just another reason for why constitutional carry is going to make things safer or safest as it could be.
No questions asked. A recent study found that about 1 in 30 people looking to buy guns...
If criminals can get guns, no question asks, without a background check in a regular gun store anywhere in America, then that means the good guys can get a gun, no questions asked, as well. And if they can constitutional carry, then that means that they can bring it with them everywhere that they go without any type of scrutiny. Which currently is only happening in a few states in the country. And so what we need to do is have that everywhere in the country, constitutional carry.
On one website had criminal records. 1 out of 30 had criminal records. We're talking about individuals can
work together. Skip ahead a little bit here.
Each time this comes up, we are fed the excuse that common sense reforms like background checks might not have stopped the last massacre, or the one before that, or the one before that. So why bother trying?
I'm going to put a link to this video in my website or in my video, you know, details, so that you can also access this full video as well. This was a live feed, so I'm not entirely sure if the link is going to last, because I don't really understand how live feeds work that become... I know that live feeds can become an actual recorded video, but... Like, the first 35 minutes of this video is basically just, you know, a blue screen. But I'll put the actual link in there so that you can watch this yourself as well. Because I'm chopping it up and I'm skipping ahead a lot, so.
He didn't have access to a powerful weapon. We maybe can't save everybody, but we could save some. Just as we don't prevent all traffic accidents, but we take steps to try to reduce traffic.
If, according to the Second Amendment, any American can go and purchase, they have the right to keep and bear arms. So it's not the president's job to save people, it's the individual's job to save themselves. By arming themselves properly, learning how to use their gun, learning how to clean and maintain their weapon, learning how to be responsible with their gun. The president cannot do that for you. And that should be made obvious by the fact that two physical objects cannot occupy the same space. I find it really fascinating how I'm actually able to keep my cool here and how calm I am, because, you know, this is really frustrating. It's probably a good thing that I'm making this video when I barely woke up and I'm drinking my coffee, because I would be fucking bouncing off the walls right now, probably, if I waited a few hours.
As Ronald Reagan once said, if mandatory background checks could save more lives, it would be well worth making it the law of the land.
But background checks cannot save lives. They only make things more dangerous. So even if Ronald Reagan says that, it, you know, hello. Come on, people.
The bill before Congress 3 years ago met that test. Unfortunately, too many senators failed theirs.
Let's skip ahead here.
Even after San Bernardino...
Let's skip ahead. It's all a bunch of gibberish, what the president is saying right now, so...
We can reduce gun violence a whole lot more.
If you want to reduce gun violence, then you need to have constitutional carry.
But we also can't wait. Until we have a Congress that's in line with the majority of Americans, there are actions within my legal authority.
Congress is in line with the majority of Americans. That's because Congress are elected officials that are supposed to be speaking on behalf of the American people. And there are ignorant people out there that don't know their head from their ass, but most Americans are fairly intelligent. It really is a shame, but honestly, people who go to college, they're usually the dumbest people on the planet. You know, farmers. You know, people who just keep their head down and they just try to do the right thing. You know, they're out there working two jobs because one isn't enough. You know, those people are usually the smartest people in America today. It's unfortunate, but the entire educational paradigm system, it's broken. But that's a whole nother subject for another time.
We can take to help reduce gun violence and save more lives. Actions that protect our rights.
So pay attention because the president is lying a lot here.
Check system. More efficient. Under the guidance of Jim Comey and the FBI, our deputy director.
If you want to make the background check system more efficient with the FBI, then you're going to have to hire more, or you're going to have to allocate, I should say, not hire more, you know, but you're going to have to take more FBI agents that are already working for the FBI, and you're going to have them working on that particular aspect of what the FBI does. The background check system, when you go through to see if you can buy your gun, it's the FBI. But if you want to make it more efficient, then you're going to have more people actually processing those applications, which is only going to cost more money because technically speaking, you know, if you allocate more FBI agents to that type of project, then technically you're going to need to hire more to fill in whatever gaps are now missing. You know, that's common sense, but, you know, so it's basically going to add a bigger cost to the taxpayers, and at the same time, you're not going to accomplish anything. If anything, you're going to make things worse. I've believed for quite some time that in order to fix this country, we need to let down our firewalls and we need to just get up and go to work and just allow people to have their free will and to do whatever it is that they want to do. You know, it's a, you know, I've always believed that in the sense that it really shouldn't matter if you have a felony or, you know, three or four misdemeanors. If you want to get a job, you should be able to get a job. Especially since you've already paid the price for your crime in jail or probation or parole. You know, you're already paying for it. It really shouldn't matter what's on your background in terms of getting employment. If anything, it would be a good idea for these people to have something to actually lose. You know, instead of making it so hard for them to get a job, and then when they do get a job, they're not making enough money to actually live on. And so that just makes things worse. And so, you know, I've said this before, but whenever people try to control things, they actually make it worse. Every single time, they make it worse. Let's continue.
Tom Brandon at ATF. We're going to hire more folks to process applications faster, and we're going to bring an outdated background check system into the 21st century.
Basically, what he just said is that he's going to be taking a lot of money and revamping a background check system that was already obsolete before it started, because it doesn't actually serve any type of purpose other than take up people's time and prevent a few people from getting a gun in a gun show or a gun store, you know. They're still getting their guns, they're simply not doing it through the same method that you and I might be doing it.
And these steps will actually lead to a smoother process for law-abiding gun owners, a smoother process for responsible gun dealers, a stronger process for protecting the people from the public from dangerous people. So that's number one.
So what about the felon who can't get a gun legally through a gun store? Who's going to protect him from the bad guys? I just said something that probably blew somebody's mind out there. This guy is so freaking stupid. It's ridiculous. It is just ridiculous. I mean, look at what he just said. And now I'm posing the question, who's going to protect the felon from the bad guy who cannot get a gun legally? A felony is not supposed to doom somebody to a life of crime forever. The way that we do things in this country, the way that we require background checks for, you know, 90% of employment in this country, that system dooms anybody with a felony and people with certain type of misdemeanors. It basically sets them up to a life of crime. It keeps them as criminals, you know, basically. You know, but just because somebody has a felony, that doesn't mean that they're a bad person. They might have a desire to, you know, clean up their life and, you know, start doing things, you know, right and living a productive life. But the system itself keeps them in a life of crime. So just because the system is broken, that doesn't mean that I'm going to ignore the truth. And so that's why I'm posing the question, who's going to protect the felon? Oh my God, this is just, this is. Yeah, so, you know, who's going to protect the felon?
Jeez. Number two, we're going to do everything we can to ensure the smart and effective enforcement of gun safety laws that are already on the books, which means we're going to add 200 more ATF agents and investigators. We're going to require firearms dealers to report more lost or stolen guns on a timely basis. We're working with advocates to protect victims of domestic abuse from gun violence.
According to the Constitution, the government does not have the authority to regulate guns at all. And so at this point in time, the president is basically saying, he's talking about how he's going to regulate guns even more than how the government has been regulating guns. And you notice earlier he talked about how this is not an incremental, you know, it's not a set of stages where they're incrementally getting ready to control guns more and more. He's contradicting himself right now, because he's talking about incrementally controlling guns more and more. That's what he's bringing into it now. So he literally said one thing and then now he's saying another. Let's skip through the applause. Let's get over that.
That law made sure that treatment for mental health was covered the same as treatment for any other illness. That's why we're going to invest 500.
Mental health treatment. The entire system is in the crapper. The entire mental health system is in the crapper. And people, you know, children are being prescribed drugs that are not even approved for children. And I know this because when I was a kid, I was approved for a drug that was not supposed to be prescribed to kids, and yet they did it anyway. And they basically, they put my own physical health at serious risk. And, you know, I look back on it now, and I haven't been on any type of medication in years. And I'm better off. I'm more in control. I'm held accountable to my own actions completely. And that was in contrast to the way that things were. And so the president is just extremely, extremely arrogant. It's ridiculous. It is just so ridiculous how he actually has faith in the mental health system. He has faith in this background check system. And it clearly doesn't work. It's impossible for it to work. And that's why we have the Second Amendment.
$1 million to expand access to treatment across the country. It's also why we're going to ensure that federal mental health records are submitted to the background check system and remove barriers that prevent states from reporting relevant information. If we can continue to destigmatize mental health issues, get folks proper care, and fill gaps in the background check system, then we can spare more families the pain of losing a loved one to suicide. And for those in Congress who so often rush...
Suicide is a personal choice. I'm not condoning or supporting it, but suicide is a personal choice. The government has no right putting their hands in the free will of Americans. That's precisely why we have the Constitution. It's because people need to be respected in their own persons, their property, and their effects and their papers. That's our Fourth Amendment right there. And so our Second Amendment, you know, I often talk about how the Second Amendment should have been the First Amendment or the last, but for whatever reason, it's the Second Amendment, but it's basically what ensures all of the other amendments. So, you know, our Second Amendment stands out in a pretty big way. But yeah, basically we have this, and I've known about this for a while, but we have this problem where we have people that believe in flawed and broken ideas in such a way that they're willing to actually go way too far to try and protect them and support them. Things like the mental health, you know, system, where we have people who are trying to fix other people. And common sense would tell the humble person just how incredibly ignorant that idea is. But unfortunately, you know, arrogance and, you know, it's a big problem in this country right now. So there's not a whole lot of people who are humble enough to actually accept the reality of the situation, because it's not easy to accept, but it is possible to accept. You simply have to choose to.
To blame mental illness for mass shootings as a way of avoiding action on guns. Here's your chance to support these efforts. Put your money where your mouth is.
The reason why that we don't want to support investing into the mental health system again is it's precisely what I've been talking about this whole time.
Number four, we're going to boost gun safety technology. Now, today, many gun injuries and deaths are the result of legal guns that were stolen or misused or discharged accidentally. In 2013 alone, more than 500 people lost their lives to guns.
That was another lie. Okay. There is no such thing as accidental discharge in a firearm. My particular handgun, for example, it has something called a stiff trigger. Some guns have a safety switch. Some guns have a stiff trigger. It, or, you know, or it, all guns have some type of measure that's built into it, but overall you have to pull the trigger to actually get the gun to go off. In addition to that, you have to have a round in the chamber as well. So you have a magazine and then you have a chamber. You actually have to have a round in the chamber. Every gun is a little different. In the case of a rifle, you might have to pull back on the bolt and actually insert it. Or if you have a feeding system in your rifle, or if you already have rounds in the actual ammo box that's in the rifle, then you simply have to, you still have to pull back on the actual bolt, and then you have to basically push it back in and close it. In the case of a handgun, you have to, either you have to pull back on the slide to get one in the chamber, or you have to, there's different handguns with, it's all relative. There is no such thing as an accidental discharge. There's stupidity. There's there's drunk people who sometimes, do things that they're not supposed to be doing when they're drunk, or when they're intoxicated, or when they're under the influence of marijuana. Sure, but there's no such thing as a quote-unquote accidental discharge. I'm sorry, but that doesn't happen. It's impossible for your gun to accidentally discharge. Some idiot, there has to be negligence on behalf of the human. So again, it's not the gun's fault, it's the human's fault. And for any of you out there who are too arrogant to accept that, I'm sorry, but that's the truth. I'm just being honest. I'm simply giving you the facts.
Accidents, and that includes 30 children younger than 5 years old. Now, in the greatest, most technologically advanced nation on Earth, there is no reason for this. We need to develop new technologies that make guns safer. If we can set it up so you can't unlock your phone unless you got the right fingerprint, why can't we do the same thing for our guns?
Okay, that right there, I would approve of that. However, I have a Note 5, and in order for me to set up the fingerprint scanner, which I do currently have set up, because I do like that technology, but in order for me to set that up, my phone also requires that I create a backup password that's basically like at least 12 characters long, and it needs to have a letter and a number. And the reason for why my phone does that is because sometimes the fingerprint scanner doesn't work. And after, I believe it's 5 attempts, I mean, anybody with a Note 5 can tell you, or an iPhone, for example, there's a certain amount of attempts, and after that maximum attempt has been reached, you now have to manually unlock your phone with your backup password, which is pretty long and a little complicated. They basically require that you use at least one number and at least one letter. So they try and make it as safe as possible. I think it's kind of cool requiring a fingerprint scanner on your gun, but it needs to be an option, not a requirement. And the reason for that is because, and here's why I strongly believe that, because when you look at the Second Amendment, the Second Amendment, part of it is there to protect us against tyranny. So if I get gunned down by the president's people, if I'm trying to protect my country because of tyranny, in the event that, a 1776 were to happen again, and if I'm gunned down, and if I'm going to die, then I would want my fellow Americans to be able to use my handgun. And so I do like that idea, having the option of a fingerprint scanner on your gun, but it needs to be an option, not a requirement. The president here would say that it needs to be a requirement, but when you look at what the Second Amendment is for, it should not be a requirement. It should be just, it can be an option, I think that's a cool idea, but just an option, not a requirement.
If there There's an app that can help us find a missing tablet, which happens to me often, the older I get. If we can do it for your iPad, there's no reason we can't do it with a stolen gun. If a child can't open a bottle of aspirin, we should make sure that they can't pull a trigger on a gun. All right?
If you have guns in your house, and if you haven't taught your children about gun safety, and if you don't have any control over your kids, then that's a totally separate issue. You can't blame the gun for that. You know, and the president actually touched on how guns go off, quote-unquote, accidentally. It's because, again, somebody has to pull the trigger.
So we're going to advance research. We're going to work with the private sector to update firearms technology. And some gun retailers are already stepping up by refusing to finalize a purchase without a complete background check, or by refraining from selling semi-automatic weapons or high-capacity magazines.
Handguns are semi-automatic. Handguns that you have to pull the trigger for each round to go off, that's a semi-automatic weapon. So the president is clearly lacking some knowledge about guns. That's probably why he's against them, because he doesn't understand what they're for, how they're made. You know, I mean, he's lacking a lot of information here.
I hope that more retailers and more manufacturers join them, because they should care as much as anybody about a product that now kills almost as many Americans as car accidents.
The amount of people that a mass shooter is going to kill with a single firearm, it has nothing to do with how many rounds goes off per minute. What matters is the person's amount of skill, because you have the possibility of a misfire, of a jammed round. You know, you've got the possibility of missing. You know, I mean, more powerful weapons that shoot more bullets per minute, they're going to be harder to control, and it's going to require more skill and experience to do so. And in addition to that, again, like I've said before, the black market is there for people who cannot get a gun legally, according to these infringed laws that we have currently in place. And so it really doesn't matter what laws you create for the law-abiding citizens. We actually want people to be able to protect themselves. The president has no control over the black market, and he has no control over the guys who get their guns, quote-unquote, illegally based on the way that the system is now. He can only control law-abiding citizens who buy their guns, quote-unquote, legally. So that right there begs the question, why even bother trying to control it in the first place? What we need to do is we need to allow people to arm themselves, and we need to allow constitutional carry. I feel like a broken record here.
I make this point because none of us can do this alone. I think Mark made that point earlier.
The president has these executive orders which allow him literally to do stuff alone. So the president just lied to you again. Even though that's not supposed to be possible, he managed to actually do it.
All of us should be able to work together to find a balance that declares the rest.
If you want balance, then again, we need constitutional carry. I feel like I should go back and review this video and see how many times I said constitutional carry. You know, I mean, Jesus. I'm going to go ahead and stop right there. And yeah, I want to show, and again, I'm going to post a link to this video so that you can watch it yourself if you want to. But let's go through my history here. And because there's one more video I want to show you, and this is a shorter video. Let's see here. Yeah, some of these videos are a little far out there, but don't worry. I'm not some nut job, you know. I like to watch them. Because first of all, what they're saying is in fact technically possible. It's highly unlikely, but it is technically possible. So I do, but I take it with a grain of salt. You know, of course, because that's really important. But there's a video here that I recently saw. Let's see. That I really want to show. Where is it at? I feel like I recently looked at it. Okay, let's see, where are you at? I feel like it should be recently on my history list. But, this my United Nations gun. No, I don't think that's it. Let's go down some more here. Let's go way, way down there. Gun Control Bruce Willis, Ice-T. That's actually a really good video, but that's not the one I want to show. I probably should have made sure I knew exactly what the video was called. Huh. Proof anti-gun people are dangerously mentally ill. That's another good video to watch. Anti-gun senator fools himself. 14-year-old girl picks a fight. Gun control advocates. Chuck Norris. This is so weird. I feel like it should be. I probably added it to my playlist. Cool gun videos. Let's look over here. And let's go all the way down to the bottom of the list. Let's see if that gives it to us here. Come on, come on. Uh-oh. The internet went out. Well, that's okay. I can use my phone as a router. All right, there we go. All right, cool gun videos. Let's go down here. Gun control. Tom Selleck, anti-gun. Okay. Well, maybe it is this one. I'm not sure. I doubt it, though.
Read the words. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. Sure, you need an organized military force to defend your country, but the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. This is the...
Let's backtrack. That's a good video to watch. Damn, I don't even know which video it is, but it's really good. Well, not sure which one it is. Let's watch this one. This one was recent. This was Christmas Eve is when this was posted, by the way.
Mr. Obama, the Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not talk about an army. That is covered elsewhere in the Constitution. It does talk about a well-regulated militia, which is made up of civilians with their own weapons. The Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not talk about protecting government or government resources, but it does talk about being necessary for the security of a free state. The Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not say a single word about hunting or sport, but it does say,
"The people's right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed."
To the American people, as many laws have been banning firearms in cities such as Chicago, New York, and Washington, D.C., have been implemented, and, as the courts get them, they are now being overthrown as unconstitutional. Even if they were not ruled on, they are an infringement to your Second Amendment rights, and you have no obligation to obey it, and the courts have no obligation to enforce it.
No one is bound to obey an unconstitutional law, and no courts are bound to enforce it.
Mr. Obama is the chief law enforcement officer of the country.
For those of you that think that anonymous are, you know, insane, they're telling us the truth in this video. They're actually quoting real facts in this video. So, you know, they're using these tactics to make their videos because they're anonymous. It's a little theatrical, you know, but they do videos like this for a reason. They're anonymous. That's what they are. And so, of course, they make videos like these. It's a little entertaining, and they do use background, you know, music and whatnot, but you know, they're actually using real facts in this video, so I'll just continue to play it.
You are responsible for the conduct of those under your command. There will be no further tolerance of any of the following. Any act to infringe on any of the Bill of Rights, as identified in the U.S. Constitution. Any act to seize or locate any firearms or ammunition. Any act to control the ownership of firearms or ammunition. Any act to control the manufacturing or sales of firearms or ammunition. Any act to document ownership, purchases, or attempts to purchase firearms or ammunition. Any act to deploy or stage for deployment any military forces or government employees or agents thereof, for the purpose of asserting control over the population, or the rights of the people, or the states, as defined in the U.S. Constitution, such as would be used in martial law. Any act to write, form, negotiate, enter into, or comply with any international treaty that would or could do any of the points mentioned previously.
Read versus Covert, 354 U.S. 1, 1957. Treaties do not confer powers not authorized by Constitution.
Any action taken by you to attempt to perform those acts, or similar acts, as interpreted by the American people, or any attempt by you to skirt your responsibility to the true office of the presidency, will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Any further attempt by you, your administration, law enforcement, or those under authority of the presidency to perform or assist in performance with any body attempting such acts.
The video that I wanted to show, it's basically showing sheriff in a few different states who are basically saying that they refuse to enforce any law that's unconstitutional. And they can do that because of the powers of state and you know, there's a difference between state power, government, and the higher level, which is where the president sits. But basically, you know, I feel like that video should have been closer up on my history, but there's an actual video, and I believe it was dated back from 2013 or something like that, but yeah, basically they're refusing to enforce any law that's unconstitutional, and there's a reason for that, and the American Constitution is not outdated at all. It's still up to date, it's still correct, and it's there for a reason.
Will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people. As those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Any further attempt by you?
As far as I'm concerned, we should have locked up Obama in prison a long time ago because of what he's done, and Hillary too, because of what she's done.
Your administration, law enforcement, or those under authority of the presidency to do any of those acts mentioned or anything similar will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Upon such acts, it is the responsibility of the Vice President and Cabinet members to immediately exercise their authority under the 25th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution to remove you from office. Failure of such act may be viewed as an act of insurrection and treason by the Vice President and Cabinet members, as such failure would be willful disregard of each of their oath of office. Upon failure of the Vice President and Cabinet members to perform such duty of your removal, it then falls on Congress to immediately force your removal by legal means. Failure of any member of Congress to perform such duty, or to hinder it in any way, will be viewed by many people as an act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as such failure would be willful disregard of each person's oath of office. Upon failure of the Congress to perform such duty, it will be the responsibility upon the United States Supreme Court for failure to act in past or present to rectify said situation. And as such, will be viewed by many people as an act of insurrection and treason against the American people. As such, failure would be willful disregard of each Supreme Court justice's oath of office. Upon failure of all the aforementioned bodies to perform such duty, it will be the authority and duty of any and all members of the United States Armed Forces to remove the President, Vice President, Cabinet members, and members of Congress, and the U.S. Supreme Court justices from power by military force. Failure by all military members to perform such duties will constitute as an act of civil war against the American people by said authorities.
This video has links to other sources. This is for news and education reasons, and so forth and the fair use. But no doubt, some people will try and have it removed. Download it and re-upload it, or pass it along. Let the truth be known. We are anonymous.
We do not forgive.
We do not forget.
So yeah, there you go. Be careful what you hear from the president. Be careful what you hear from anybody, including myself. Always verify what you hear. Don't just blindly believe what somebody tells you. You need to have critical thinking skills. You need to be able to think for yourself. This is absolutely crucial. MassageBF.com. Thanks for watching. Over and out.